Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, or very, very good morning to everybody around the world tuning in for this G League Season 2 matchup. I am Toby Wokanobi, bringing your English live stream with Sun Tzu, my commentator who has joined me for the earlier group stages and now gets to come back for our semi-final matchup. It is a best of five semi-final matchup. The way this worked is we play two games today and then the remaining games are played tomorrow. Same starting time tomorrow, but they split the semi-final into two. Both semi-finals we play it this way, with the second semi-final, IG going up against LGCN starting in 2 days' time. This is the way it runs, and then there is a one-month break before the grand final, which will be held in the Mercedes-Benz Arena in China. But of course, we are going to get ourselves inside the game in a couple of moments' time. Let's have a look through our teams as the Chinese stream comes up, or actually through the group stages, the grid we're looking at, in fact, for where we are. I want to introduce to you Sun Tzu. Man, welcome back. It's great to have you here.
Thank you, Toby. Thank you. It's good to be here, and a lovely day it seems.
It is a beautiful day. It's an absolutely beautiful day. LGD International versus Tongfu. The birds are not singing. The weather is overcast. Could you ask for more? I don't think you could. I do not think you could. I love the Chinese guys are running through their stats right now, so this must excite you a lot. Look at NA as well as Batrider. 24 and 23 bans.
Indeed. They are the superstars of the tournament, but one of the unspoken heroes and one of my absolute favorite is Caudill. He's actually got a 73% win rate and he's been picked 15 times, so that's fairly popular, fairly good.
Yeah, it's the Chinese. I wasn't gonna say the Chinese. Actually, it's something which IG I know used a lot during their stages, and it was really it was fantastic. Like initially, we saw it where it was being used in conjunction with the Lone Druid, and we had this amazing like pullback, like send your bear back to base, and then all of us. Actually, no, there was Chen and Lone Druid did that, but it was Caudill who you TP back to base, and then he'd just bring you back in again with your full life and everything you got.
Yeah, and I mean any hero who can sort of. Who doesn't usually have the mobility to split push can become a split pusher with the help of Caudill, and you just sort of you can do so much with that relocate and it's awesome.
It is awesome when like you see that split push coming, and it works so well with so many different lineups. Like I'm just looking at LGD right now, and like they do love their pushing strats, but they also love like blending it with this form of like aggression-y rotate. It's what forced every team to ban out Chen and Enchantress at the start. So because it all came off the back of Misery and that number four role, just rotating around and finding all these openings with the help of 1-4-3-7. These two guys together, just it puts fear into every single lane. I'm wondering right now if Tongfu is going to draft for stable lanes or if they draft for their game style.
Yeah, I kind of feel like you have to keep on batting out those Chen and Enchantress. I feel like LG International is slowly sort of figuring out a way to play around that. But the difference in terms of how well they do is too great. So it's the same as, well, now we all know why, but in the first games between IG and VG Gaming, IG was banning out AM in the first ban stage every time because they knew that City with an AM was too much. You don't want to do that. And the same thing goes here, but it's for a support player, so.
Yeah. Well, no one ever likes it. And I know, actually, who was it? Was it you or was it? No, I think it was Buffer Man was the one who was bitterly complaining about all anti-mages because every team, when they lose one game, they pick up an anti-mage as a fallback to protect the anti-mage at all costs and then win game in late. Which is really funny, too, because now we've seen PLs coming out stopping the anti-mage from doing what he likes to do. And, in fact, to a point, wins the game because PL is a better scaling carry at the end of the game.
If more anti-mages leads to more PLs, I'm perfectly happy with more anti-mages. I like Final Answer. He's cool.
It's good to see the Chinese commentators here in the chat being very, very neutral. saying Tom Fu's going to pick Lycan. Careful. It's a troll, guys. It's a troll because they're saying it back at because Pycat's the only one. It's the only time we've seen a selection of Lycan. Actually, no. Was there another Lycan?
No, I think he was the only one. I'm not sure, actually. Let's see.
Because I'm remembering a jungle Lycan, but because I've been casting the defense, I'm not 100% sure if I saw it in the defense or if I saw it here.
Just one Lycan in G League.
So. All right. So one Lycan G League.
Yeah. Right. And still that Night Stalker for Mu. It's actually, we spoke about this last time that I was on the broadcast, that I was expecting Night Stalker to fall off a bit, and we hadn't seen it quite happen yet at that point, but he is actually sort of falling off by now. He's not winning that many games, and he's not even getting picked that much.
It's kind of been funny because Night Stalker, we started off with him with this like aggressive roaming kind of thing, and yeah. Pycat looks like he's in a shotgun mood. with the Night Stalker, like we went through this diving through ganking kind of strat, then we went to a tri lane move around and just try and destroy all. And then we went into this team fight kind of thing, and then we had a push lineup. We're basically going through the four different types of Dota throughout this entire G League, depending on what team wants to play what kind of thing. Oh, and of course, late game farm. So yeah, we also had that one.
Yeah, well, it is that sort of equilibrium that you get as people figure out how to play against any given lineup. It keeps on changing, and the pressure to keep on changing at an event like this is just so much higher than usual. So,
man, it must be really cold there for Misery to be wearing not only his jacket but also another jacket on top of that jacket. You saw the guy over there from Tongfu where he had like a jacket up on his legs as well, like trying to keep himself warm. I think he had both his hands inside there, trying to keep them warm. Like, I know the StarCraft 2 players have like these heat packs. I still want to see that damn visage. They put it in there for a reason. Sorry, I just see that and get really, really annoyed. Sun Tzu, he'll be coming back in a moment. Looks like we just lost him from the call. But he'll return. Finland Internet.
Yeah.
Yeah, welcome back, man. Welcome back.
I have no idea why that happened. I'm back on my 100 megabyte connection.
No idea why, man. Yeah.
And for Brax, they showed up that Darkseer. It's actually one of their most picked heroes. They've picked it 9 times, I think 17 recorded games. So that's probably one hero that they'll be looking to pick up very, very early in the draft, if they can.
Yeah, we'll see what happens with that draft, because I'm really not expecting, like, I don't know if LGD International want to change. I think in game number one, they'll just do a feeler, because I know LGD International will have something prepared just in case something happens.
Yeah.
But they won't use it until game two, because they know that they get through this, and all of a sudden, if they get through this semi-final, then they're in the grand final, and that's when they can start pulling out the strats and win the big, big title. And they're going to need it up against IG as well as LGDCN. These are two teams that you can't rely on what you've been doing beforehand, because they're just going to like see it and just combat it very, very easily. And I know that LGD International have something prepared up their sleeves.
Yeah. I'd expect them to, I expect Tongfu to ban out that Chen and Enchantress, and from what we've seen so far from LGD International, their response seems to be to get a setup stun and someone like Lina or Leshrac. So that's sort of the way that I see them going in terms of support. I think if we see banning out of the wooders, there might be quite a bit of freedom in terms of picking your carries, and that might mean we get to see the Luna again for Pycat. So,
maybe this is where we head. I'm a little bit concerned when I don't see the in-game. That sometimes does happen.
77% of Chinese think LGD International should win this.
Really?
Yep.
70%. I missed that on the live stream. 77%.
Yep. So a
Well,
quarter of them.
if you're playing the odds, you would agree. Like LGD
Yep.
International, they've been the strength team in this. They beat LGDCN. So hey, why wouldn't you say that they should be able to take this out? There's no reason why you can't.
Definitely, and whoa, AM bat.
Yeah, Misery.
Snap.
They're not giving any kind of option for late game for Tongfu. And for them that kind of works. Like they don't want to be dealing with the Animage. It's just a ban out of not wanting to be annoyed, I think. It's not
Yeah.
because it's like, oh wait, no, that's not gonna it's gonna counter our strategy too well. Because I'm pretty sure they're still gonna be rotating around looking for kills, but a blinking Animage would be frustrating to kill as well. So yeah, I suppose it does a little bit annoy them.
Yeah, and it's also of the harder carries, it seems to have been the fallback for Hal, and they ban out Cuddle.
It's really a bait. Like we've got Misery up on the screen. He's able to get that Darkseer in
Yeah.
and feel very, very confident with that one. But yeah, with the Animage and Coddle being banned out, it forced Hal to ban out not only NA but also Batrider. So we sit now in this position where Hal has to decide, like, does he give Veronica that Magnetor, which has been basically the star over the last, I say the star, and also the failure over the last couple of games of G League.
Yeah, and definitely, if you're looking for a Rubick player to try and replicate what YXY did, then 1437, there's your Rubick man.
Yeah, he is an amazing Rubick player. He just needs that nice coupling hero. But then again, that's also not really been a difficult thing to get hold of. Like that's extra support hero. Like you got Lautrec, you got Lina, you got Sven, you got all these different like couple up AoE stunners that you can combine up with LGD's lineup, and that's what they're gonna be looking for. If you have something like a Vakken, there's your Nightstalker for Mu. So the answer straight back again, but it's still gonna be very, very cautious. Like we know what's gonna happen right now because Misery, he's already got the Darkseer. We combine this up with Magnetor and a nice AoE damager, and the problems just keep coming for Tongfu then if they get caught out. But it's that whole question of if. That's why it's been this hot and cold kind of thing. And we go with Chen.
The Chen and then maybe the Rubik.
Maybe. Maybe. If they don't get it, I wouldn't be surprised if Tongfu takes
Well,
it, but
if they take the Rubick, that means Tongfu can't really pick up the Magnus. But if they pick up the Magnus, Tongfu can pick up the Rubick. But then, yeah.
there is a difference though right now is if Misery picks up Rubick, like while Rubick's great because he can steal everything, he's got Lone Druid, he's got Nightstalker on the field. He's,
Yeah.
he kind of wants to know what the supports are going to be before he really commits into Rubick, because if Rubick can't steal something which you really, really want, then
Yeah.
like he's just a Telekinesis and Fade Bolt then. And
Yeah, that's true.
his ulti isn't as powerful, but if you see something like a Magnetor, then instantly like hell yes, I want that Rubick, I want that pickup. Because then you can get the Four Staff and Blink Dagger and steal that reverse polarity and catch all of Tongfu out of position. That's when you can look at that kind of lineup. But right now they're looking at a lineup which has silence and has a lot of strength behind it. And when you got a lot of strength behind it, we're not going to see Rubick kill anybody off. So it needs to be something else.
Yeah, I actually feel that. Nice,
Yeah.
the Shadow Demon for 14%. I feel like they might pick Furion right now. Because, well, no, it's not Long DD drafting. Long DD really loves his Furions, even though they haven't exactly been that
Yeah,
great.
we're not going to remind him of those before this game. Luckily, too, he's not tuning into this broadcast, so we can say whatever the hell we want, and we won't remind him of it. But yeah, so
Yeah,
that.
Long DD, the guy who ruins the cool channel.
Yeah.
If you don't get the joke,
Yeah,
no
they
worries.
won't get the joke because they
No.
were in the lobby where we saw LongDD connected into the game and instantly joined our broadcasting channel. So that's yeah, that was the reason why yeah, it was a cool channel when he connected in. I love that there's so much conversation going in with LGD right now. Like it's really getting involved. I think everyone, Sergey's just sitting there going, "Yeah, I'm a boss. Just give me something, I'll kill." But it's actually funny because we got like Pycat, Misery, Brax, they're all getting together over there, and 1437 as well. Remember, 1437 used to be the drafter for Mouse Sports and quite successful, I might say, as the drafter before he left. Then Kuro took it up.
Oh, there comes the Magnus.
Yeah, it was bound to happen. It was bound to happen. But this is now Tongfu with three heroes that require a large level of farm, and there's no support heroes in the pool for them. And LGD have got all the support heroes they want and just require a mid solo as well as require a hard farmer. The number one and number two position is what's missing right now for LGD. And that's going to be answered in a couple of moments' time. But the question is, what does Howe think they're going to run? It's difficult to really work it out. You know this. You kind of know that it's going to be Darksteer on the long lane, because Darksteer doesn't have to worry about that lane anymore. Like it is the ban against Misery. Okay. That's really fair enough, considering you got Chen on the back of it, and with a Lycan, we're going to see towers going down.
Yeah,
but
the pushing would be a bit too much.
It's the only, like, that's the only time we've had a ban against Lycan in, I don't know, however many long times, just because of that one game. That one game he picked it. That one game. It sits in your mind, doesn't it? It really sits in your mind.
Indeed. I'm just wondering who Tongfu will get now supports right now. Rubik, Chikiro, Caudle out.
Well, they've still got Lashrak, they've still got Lina.
Yeah.
And that's going to be the ones to couple up with, well, if Magnetor gets his thing.
They don't have a setup stun for
They've got Void. They've got Void from Nightstalker, and that slow will be enough to do it. Or a possibility for an Entangle. So they do have a couple of options when it comes to the setups for it. But you don't always need a setup stun. Like, we always say you need a setup stun for, like, Lina and, as well as Lashrak. But a higher class enough player can land those stuns with enough prediction. It's just not guaranteed. It's not a guaranteed stun.
Yeah.
And they ban out the Necro as well. Man, this is so focused banning against LGD. But the funny thing is, too, it was LGD CN that played the Necrolite yesterday.
Yeah, well, Pykett has played Necrolite as well. He lost with it. As everyone almost has.
Almost.
Almost.
Almost. What was it? The score for the Necrolite for Sylar was 0 for 2?
Yeah.
Until yesterday, where now it's now 1 for 2?
1 for 3.
What?
Yeah, 1 for 3.
1 for 3. Has he had 3 losses?
No, 1 for 2.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Enchantress. SF's the final ban out now. And that would have been a nice damage dealer. That would also couple up with the SF, but I'm still interested to know if it's going to be like what is really going to be the high carry here for Misery. What does he want to go? Do we look at like? Not does he try PL? I doubt it. If he's looking at Tongfu with this kind of lineup with so many melee heroes, I wouldn't be surprised if Void is also something he's considering.
Well, Luna's still in the pool.
That is true. But Luna won't have as much damage up against Magneton, Nightstalker, and Lone Druid, and her timing, I don't know if it's be quite right. Yeah, Nakes is the safer pickup. Nakes is the safer pickup. You're going up against so much damage from so many strength heroes, and you've got a nice lot of disables coming out. Of course, Magneton as well as Lone Druid can get through that rage, but it's the more stable pickup to come out with the Nakes. And then we look towards our mid solo, and if we do have like a Blink TA coming in towards that mid lane, which I got a funny feeling that is what Misery is going to pick up as the last one. Then we've also got a Nakes bomb coming the way of someone in Tongfu. I would love it though if they go for the
it
puck.
Might be Storm Spirit as well.
Storm? Yeah, of course. We haven't
That's
seen Sergei.
That G really loves, or used to love.
Yeah, but difficult though with a Storm Spirit because Nightstalker does have that silence, and that's the concern.
Yeah,
that's my bigger concern. What I'd actually like to see is almost them go for a call to Shrak. Give Sergei a call to Shrak. Let them push down the towers very early on and gives them a lot more nuke damage when it comes to the team fights, and they'll start to melt through all of them. The only downside is it still requires Nakes to have a large level of farm to get through that through the life points of Lone Druid and his bear.
That might work. I feel like this is a bit more of a sort of active on the map ganking strategy rather than just pushing strategy.
There's gotta be the Luna.
What?
Means they can run Nakes in the middle lane. Because we got so many melees, hey, why not? And that's where that damage will come from.
Yeah, it might be that way.
Yeah. It will be, man, trust me. Trust me. I've been watching enough Dota of late that if I can't predict this, I'm never getting something completely different. They could also, if they want to, go a little bit more aggressive up towards that top. throw Chen inside the Dire jungle, but not all the way into it. Because that's something too which LGD have been doing very, very well. They don't just let a carry sit on the off lane and farm up. They actually get in the mix. And between Shadow Demon and Nakes, they've got a lot of control over any hero they really want to lock down and give them time to do that damage. But it will need to come on the back of like Chen having a decent creep, having a follow-up stun.
Indeed.
And
Witch Doctor.
The new and improved Witch Doctor as well, remember? The man with the ulti that hits everybody or bounces.
Yeah, the ulti is really nasty if you can actually get it off. But you have to get it off first.
All right, so let's get ourselves straight inside the game. Yeah, because getting it off is going to be very, very difficult. Lucian Beam can stop him. We've got, Nakes can't stop him. Darkseer is back, Shadow Demon's Disruption. Actually, there's only three abilities that will stop him from getting his ultimate off. And most of the time, LGD will be trying to focus most of those over onto like a Magnetor or a Nightstalker trying to hold them out of play.
You can still depend on Misery to pick up a couple of guys. A couple of guys to stomp.
That's if you can get Centaurs. That's if you can get in position. Witch Doctor, all he's got to do is just hold himself just out slightly outside of the line of sight and then just go from there. Yeah, let's check out our lane. So it is going to be LGD sending Brax up towards the top lane to start with. Sentry wards are here, 1437 and Misery. Yeah, they're going to run an aggressive lane and leave God, Sergei, in the middle lane as the Darkseer. And that throws Pinecat onto the off lane. So, hey, that's a little bit wrong with as far as stable lanes go.
Yeah, that was actually what I was thinking, saying that it might be that aggressive tri lane with Lifestealer.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
And then how's going to be going in the middle lane as the Lone Druid? He's already going to start to try and pull experience for Veronica, who's heading down towards the bottom lane as the Magnetor. And then towards our top lane, Longdidi and Sunshang, the two supports as Lina and Rubik, respectively. And that leaves Mu as our final and signature hero, Nightstalker.
I wonder if they were thinking that Zongfu was running some kind of aggressive trial in as well, and that's why they figured they could try against it.
They could have been, but Witch Doctor's not really the greatest for an aggressive tri lane. And I'm only saying that because his stun is a projectile, and it lets you move in and away. And if you're going up against a Shadow Demon, it's not, obviously, like you get that disruption off, and then, hey, it doesn't really work. Nice illusion room, by the way. We're seeing 1437. It's just a small bit of control, but it's going to block that 30-second camp, the easy camp, at the very, very start. There's a little bit of a ping coming out, so... How will DC himself back out again and then rejoin the fight in a moment? As all the players just chilling for the moment as we have to wait. As he reconnects back in again. Yeah, but this top lane for LGD International, it's a dangerous thing to do, especially now that Tongfu have that ward watching the top rune. Yeah, they're not doing it. Misery knows that to get inside that jungle, he can't do it up against heroes like Lina as well as Witch Doctor, because if they do move as two, which is what we've seen 1437 as well as Misery do a hell of a lot, they move together always as two with a couple of creeps. They stick together close and then they nail them down. But with Witch Doctor, that's the thing he likes. He likes people to remain close because then those stuns just keep locking them in position. It's very, very hard to get away because the cast just keeps bouncing around. It's a real pain in the butt when you're looking for positioning during team fights.
And apparently I'm a bit silent.
On the live stream? Or in Dota TV?
So. I believe it's on the live stream.
On the live stream, I've now brought you up, so you should be okay now.
Okay, cool. Yeah.
Apologies to those guys at home that wanted to hear Sun Tzu's amazing talking. Over my awesome analogy, which was completely wrong. But it's, hey, I recovered saying the supports would rotate around. And hey, what'd you believe? It's LGD International with rotating supports. But they are bringing like Chen down towards this bottom lane and into the jungle. And that's going to be a bit of a pain in the butt for this very early stages for Brax, because his supports are nowhere near him. So he's going to get very minimal to no farm up on this top. But the trade-off has got to come on the bottom lane. But we've got Magnetor up against Luna. And there's only so much harassment damage that Pinecat is capable of doing.
Yeah, how the hell do you run a 1v3 Lifestealer?
Well, I suppose you do have Rage, and that's your
technical
escape mechanism.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking as well. That You can if you can use that rage. And I suppose, actually, since both of the stuns that they have are stuns that you can avoid with well-timed rage.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, that might actually work.
Both the cask as well as and the instant sentry ward suit, so he can't be seen when he moves up and down. Well, and Londi D gets to have a fight with the fake 1437. And what creeps are we getting for Misery? Misery's first creep is a Wilkin. Not exactly what he wants, but we haven't seen him gank with it before. The toughness aura does let him dive back past those towers just a little bit further. At the same time, you look at God now going on Howl. So this is the answer for Tongfu, where they find their farm for the Lone Druid, feeling maybe a little bit too much pressure on the top. Because LG International have shut down Lone Druids in the past, and there's a line already being drawn. Misery wants to gank, wants to smoke up, and then rotate up, but they need to smoke up together.
Yep.
So they dive a little bit deeper, and they find a centaur. So that's what he needed. Kill off the small fry, and then go for a gank, and middle lane will be their focus. Pop it.
Yeah, and Tongfu isn't even really punishing this lifestealer. It's just...
Did that bear see it for a moment? No, I don't know if he did or not. Hal resummons it and comes back. Yeah, that bear was looking for a scout. He's looking inside the jungle and couldn't see anything. But it's a small little thing, but it lets Hal know that the heroes are missing.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then he moves down. The reveal is there. The smoke breaks at 1437. And this surprise gank is over. But he can't get farm on the lane. That's why he's trying to bring the bear back in close enough.
And we have our answer how Brax is going to cope on that.
Hal, trouble in mid. Whoa, Misery. Mistiming this time. Disruption will be there. He doesn't have another follow-up stomp. God, he's trying to block him in. Yes, Hal. They actually locked him in there. Locked him in with the centaur and the disruption illusion. So they'll lose the centaur. And I thought Misery blew it then with missing the first stomp, but... He was able to get that lockdown and get the kill. That's a Warcraft 3 surround. That's what that was.
Indeed, indeed. And yeah, Brax is actually doing quite well here. He's getting some levels, and he was pulling from the nearby camp, pulling the his own way. So to counteract the Tongfu pulling.
It's a nice way to do it. Also, it looks like Misery has been nice to God and stacked up an easy camp for him. So, got a large amount of money coming in the way of Darkseer, and already with the regeneration rune. So, we can throw everything he wants out against Hal. And Hal, he also knows his farm in the middle lane. While it's 10 for 3, Darkseer up to 18 for nil now after taking out that last camp. And he has that first blood. And the death, of course, is over on Lone Druid. And that hurts him hard, man. That hurts him hard. Like, his gold per minute's going to drop so fast. Like, look at the gold per minute for Darkseer. It's 554. And Lone Druid sits there at 217. Even Lunar is getting more than Nightstalker by 24 points.
It's a fairly annoying lane for that Lone Druid either way because of those iron shells. They just keep on nibbling away.
I think, Sun Tzu, your problem is inside Dota TV.
Okay.
But you're just a little bit too quiet there. Because I've got you pretty well cranked up over here. If I crank you more, you'll start to distort and probably blow my ears out. so just look at your in-game transmission volume and see if you can pump that up a little bit. Should be in your Steam settings. Well, no trouble for Brax right now. Just voided a little bit in Sunshine and put him back, but it's not really trouble, is it? He just tanks it up, and then a rotation happens again. So 1437 and Misery have already affected the middle lane, so now they're coming up towards the top. They want to make sure Mu at least dies once before the first nighttime cycle. And they should be able to do it. Brax coming over, seeing the camps being pulled on the side. And Tongfu, well... This Londi D farming from range with a slave and then with a light strike array. Both stuns being thrown out already. But it's so low mana cost for Alina to do that kind of thing.
And just chasing them away with that tornado.
Well, it also works for Sunshine because he pulled the creep wave all the way back. However, it is really annoying for Move. In fact, he's not looking too great in life. Getting away from that tornado so he can probably pop the salve just in case this engagement is coming. No, he goes back into the tornado so he can cop more damage. And then the creep wave. But with this creep wave up, LG can dive this.
And
the cask has just been used too. That stun's lost. Brax is going inside the trees. Disruption starts off on the side. The heal is out there from the Witch Doctor, but he's already dead. Open wounds with a nuke out from Misery. It's more than enough damage. They can hold this creep wave at bay. Witch Doctor's on the sidelines. Moo's not quite sure if he can go in on this. Longdidi's just trying to force him back out again. But the Slave only really hits on the Welcome. That's going to be a little bit of farm going their way. Actually, no, the creep wave killed it off. So they only get the experience.
So, who are the thunkin'? Lifestealer tri-lane working.
Yeah, man. Lifestealer tri-lane's all the new thing.
Yep.
It's all about setting up with open wounds and following through with a large amount of damage.
It's going to be interesting to see if Lifestealer truly catches on, because so far we've only seen a couple of teams really play Lifestealer during this tournament. He has a lot of potential. A lot.
Well, he's been all over the European scene like a hot rash.
Indeed.
Veronica and I want to keep my eyes closed on that lane, because I know soon we're going to hit that level 6 up in Veronica, and we'll see that reverse polarity come into play. While Sergei is really controlling at this middle lane, 38 for 3 up against 22 for 9. Al's just not having an easy time, even his bears always remaining low on life. Which means jumping in on him is quite easy to do. Like, he hits level 6, does he go what he normally does in that third point up into Synergy and leave his ultimate? How does he feel? No, he feels pressure. He goes into that ultimate form. And rightly so. Misery in 1437's already rotating in towards the middle lane. And how? Well, he was down a little bit further, but Misery wants another creep. He needs another creep. He's going to get one too. Gets a troll and then wants to walk away. Coming towards that middle lane. Hearing how, he's now inside the Alban form. Maybe not enough damage to finish this one off. Disruption. Bear's on the way back out again. This Bear's going to die just because of the... nice entangle on Misery. Not really intended, but it's going to work anyway. How? Get this Bear. Kill off the Bear. That Blur's damage is going to be enough to kill him off. Yes, it is. 1437 kills the Bear, and in return kills off the lone Druid. Chen does die for the cause, and now,
we're
God,
here,
Sergei, he
there.
Can't search for one more second. Malediction is there, and, now on the run. Darkseer, he's got enough movement speed. There's not enough damage. Bounce stun, gonna hit, but doesn't bounce to anything, but it buys enough time for Moo to get that Void out and finish the job. The sun
sets on and who goes hunting for Luna?
Yeah, straight down towards the bottom lane. Why not, man? It's nighttime. Keep that pressure on. There's already the shockwave. There's no extra
farming, so.
There's no extra mana here for Veronica, so he can't do much more. And same with Moo, they're both empty with both their bottles. And Pykak can just juke this around. He's got a good movement speed, 380, and well, 405 at some points, up against the 431 of Moo. And back down south and pops a Tranquil Boot, so they can't kill him off.
Yeah, and that bonus night vision, he saw it coming, so.
Beauty of Luna Blessing.
Indeed.
And Gogus just chill in the middle lane for the moment. All the space in the world that he wants.
But yeah, they will really need it, that kill on Pyka. He's going to ball out of control here.
Nope. Now we're going to have him move in. Disruption already start with Catcher. Able to get the target, but the skewering away just the illusions. And a double TP came in. Moo wants to go in. They're only going to get this... well, not even going to get the Dark Troll. Nah, Lina. Nah, can't finish the job. Right-click not enough. Moo's still coming in to snipe it out.
Tankiest troll of your life.
One quick lizard beam stops Moo from following it down. Just a mini stun, but it's enough space. But this is more time that we've seen Ninestalker rotating around. Sure, he got that kill in the middle lane, but it still came at a cost. And now up towards the top lane. How? They give him space up here, and then Brax is the man to go up against it. Brax with phase boost, so his right clicks now do some decent damage. But we also have to remember too what's going to happen in our later portion of the game. Like, there's no points up in it for Veronica just yet, because he's gone for the normal build, which is those 2 points up in the skewer, 4 points up in shockwave, and then the 1 point up in the reverse polarity. But after he gets another point up into skewer, we should see a couple of points come in for empower. And that's when Moo starts to hit harder. That's when the lone druid starts to get a little bit harder as well.
Yeah, and this rotation that Tung Fu is doing and trying to find kills and such, it is sort of what they need to do, but also, who's going to stop Brax from farming now? And then you're going to have a farmed Lifestealer.
Hal's doing it pretty well at the moment. Up towards that, well, down towards the middle lane. 1437, quick disruption. Just trying to take the nice stalker out. Bounce not going to fly. Bounces back up to the troll. And they're chasing down 1437. Back into the Iron Shell damage. Long DD gets one new cop before he dies. And a pick off the Shadow Demon at the back end of play. But Sergei really want to jump in to initiate. Mu, he's going to dive in on Misery right now. Veronica's already here. He can skewer in reverse polarity, especially when there's three coming in. Look at how low Misery is. 55 HP. He will get to live. The Iron Shell went up on him, trying to make it harder for Mu to finish him off. So he couldn't do the job, and Pycat's the man who TP's in towards the mid. Bounce stun just keeps on going through, but Veronica won't dive it any further. He knows Pycat's still in the neighborhood, and that's a dangerous place to be. He also doesn't want to risk his Arcane Boots. He's only 80 gold away from having that.
Yep. Come on. Kill that, Magnus. Kill.
Man, it's difficult. It's difficult to really kill off the Magnetor.
Yeah, he hasn't actually died a single time yet.
Well, he hasn't been pressured at all. And this is the reason why Magnetor has been able to, like, slip back in even after his skewery work. Most Magnetors aren't focused in the early stages of the game. They just try and be dealt with in the later portions of the game.
Yeah, but that usually comes on the back of the team itself running an aggressive tri-lane. But this time, it was the opponent who chose to give the Magnus that space.
Hmm. That's true, because they try to rotate and control the other lanes instead. They want to control Mu more during this nighttime. Like, our nighttime is now 3 a.m., so we're starting to run out of the nighttime. And Mu, this not going to happen during this push in the middle lane unless this really extends a long, long time. But the T1 tower is just so low that LGD forcing this tower down is easy enough. They've got their entire team here right now forcing this out. The only person who's missing from this is, in fact, Lone Druid. There's already Veronica. He's managed to get that double damage. Nice reverse polarity. Three caught in it, but not a disruption by 1437. It keeps Pycat alive for the moment, and he can get that Eclipse off. He'll live through this. Chen was the only one to go down during this, and God's going to keep on diving. Brex, open wounds off cooldown, 8 seconds time, chasing down Long DD. And Veronica, you got a great reverse polarity, but 1437, the playmaker.
Shit, that was crucial. That was clutch. I was honestly so riding off that Luna at that point.
Alright, so 11-40. 11-40, 6-4 is the kill count. This is just LG International. That's the first tier 1 town. That's what it took to bring down the first tier 1 tower. And Mu is just going to be chilling on the bottom lane in the meantime, because he knows that in one hour of Dota time, night time is over. He's no longer got this great movement speed. And he had that during that engagement in the middle lane, but just... Again, the Shadow Demon pickup for LGD International, it works so damn well. It works so damn well.
Indeed, it has worked, and actually you can see it on the net where it's God is in the lead, and they have three out of the top four right now, so it's looking quite well for them. It's not that big of a difference yet, but it's certainly going the way that LGD International wants it to go right now.
Yeah, it's going to keep that momentum rolling, or else we know what can happen once we hit our second night time. Because Nightstalker, even though it wasn't a flawless first night time for him, it was one kill, one death, and two assists. We do know he's still got the treads up. He's got the bottle. He's got wand, and he's farming up on the bottom lane when heading into the second night time. So depending on how much farm he's able to get through the day and how many levels he can get. Like, at this point, there's not a single point up in that ultimate. But we know he'll have at least 1 point, if not 2 points, up by the second nighttime. And that's going to be a very, very long nighttime for LGD. But they do have Luna, so it's kind of like this vision counter at least. But, yeah, they move everyone towards the top lane. They want to go in. The Bear's a little bit too far out. Howe is just scouting out with it. And Brax wants to go on it. Iron Shell damage plus his right-click and the catcher. They're throwing a lot out for this one, and Brax in behind the tower. He sees the entire team there. He's just trying to bait out abilities so he can pop that rage and bring the Bear back down again. The Bear's already looking pretty damn low. And he might even require a resummon, but the push onto the tower, it's almost like smoke and mirrors. Moves caught out of position, has to pop off his ultimate. But the right-click Lucent Beam as well. More enough to bring him down. Now Wish Doctor. This time he's going to get a good Oldman. Someone's got to stun him. Loosen Beam does the job. Brax sits inside his rage. There's so little damage coming up from Veronica. He's already used his reverse polarity. They kill up the Wish Doctor for the price of the SD. The infestation is in Brax inside of God. Comes back out again. Wants to go for Veronica. We lost Lena on the back end. Magnetor goes down too. Double kill for the supporting Misery. And the tier 1 tower to boot. That was just great jump in, jump out play by LGD.
Yeah, that was just... Tong Fu just melted. That Lifestealer going to town. Now he's 202. Yep.
Yeah, this is exactly where they want to have the Nakes. And not exactly where they want to have this bear. They've got to know there's a resummon bear, so it's worth committing to kill it off. Open wounds is available if they want to do it with a loosened beam, but they're just keeping it low. Bear can't be resummoned for another minute, and it comes back in again. Howl's being very, very like frivolous with this bear. Brax, he's on low life, but with this Iron Shell on him, with all these melee heroes that want to come in on him, they cop a lot of damage when they do so. And yeah. Now they're baiting Tong Fu to come inside the jungle. There's no reverse polarity. There's a little bit of harassment. Sunsheng low on life. Disruption goes off on one side, looking for Veronica. And they are slowing him down, forcing him to skewer away in defense. And now open wounds again. Not going to be there. Sitting inside the rage, open wounds on cooldown. Bear back towards the front lines. And Tong Fu, they still want to initiate it on this one. LGD is like they're trying to play them in. Harass them down bit by bit. Brax almost able to kill up that bear again. Howl might have to resummon. Loosen Beam kills it off. So even more farm comes the way of Pycat, and they're just slowly whittling down these towers. Another disruption coming out. Back in again, and the wall. They get a copy of Veronica, and Mu has to walk straight through the wall again. He's on such low life. Wish Dr. Keel's over. The Laguna Blade flew out from Long DD to try and kill off Pycat. We've got an Overclock on him, up on him, as well as Magic Wand Charger. So all the farm in the world gets a Light Strike at Ray at least, but loses his own life. It's now 12 for 5, and LGD are manhandling Tong Fu.
And if you look at just damage that that Lifestealer is doing per right click, I mean, he hasn't even been like the core farmer, and with, at best with all the buffs up, he was at like 180 damage per hit.
That's the beauty of it, man. That's the beauty of it.
An unfarmed Lifestealer.
It's coming through a farmed up Luna. Like,
yeah.
Luna has great levels. 4 points up in the Luna Blessing.
And,
now Mu
and they also had the Command Aura from the creep.
So you rack all that up. Now top lane gank. Disruption is there. The bear might do what it can for Howl, but Brax opens up in a rage. Attack speed, open wind, slow him down. 1437 keeping his distance too. And they kill up the lone druid. And he's going to respawn and then have 20 seconds where he can't resummon his pet. But it's another kill, another pick off. And even now, God, he's soloing up too. He's going for Mu in the middle lane. The stun, the Malivus, Veronica goes trying to skewer him back out again, but couldn't get in a better position for it. Surging away, God inside the trees, magic wand, he can pop it off. Oh, he avoids the skewer, but he has a shockwave to the groin and does go down.
Yeah, and by this point, it's no longer a unfarmed Lifestealer. He's almost caught up with Howl.
And we get to see for the first time the new animation on the live stream for Nightstalker.
Oh yeah, true.
When they change the clock out and say, this is darkness. We're just going to quick pause by 1437, so guessing a misclick. Just a misclick. But Pycat's adding now pressure towards the bottom lane. And we'll have to bring down this tier 1 tower on the bottom. This is the strong LGD we're expecting to come out in today's game.
Yeah. And I mean, even with a Lone Druid and Night Stalker and all that.
It's not enough.
Tong Fu's actually trying to go for their first tower.
Their problem is they don't have that right click damage. Like I was saying, Empower is going to give him a buff for it. We haven't seen a single point for Veronica in that. Night Stalker, he can't get close enough. The second he tries to get in for an engagement, Brax will open wounds him, and there's no BKB that's going to help him get through that. Even the movement speed from Nighttime Darkness Hunter in the Night is not enough. And then he gets harassed down by Loosen Beams of Luna. He's got 1437's Disruption, or if he needs to, he can purge him. And Sergei, he can also give Surge to whoever needs to get himself away or in. All these openings are here. And the problem is, Tong Fu, they don't have the positions when it comes to fight. Sunsheng is this Witch Doctor. It's not doing anything. He throws out a casket. It's more being used to push back the creep wave than it is to really take the kills. He got one ultimate off, but then Loosen Beam by Luna. She's always got one up her sleeve. Throws it out, the mini stun cancels off the ultimate, and there's no way in all hell Wish Doctor will ever get to a point where he will have Now we see him dewarding, and Sergei backs him up. Iron Shell, also the damage coming up by 14373 Purge, ensures he cannot run away.
And you could just see how safe they felt. They were like all over the Tong Fu jungle. And Tong Fu just wasn't willing to commit to anything.
Well, they could have gone in
5v1 at some point, but...
They couldn't commit. They got no damage coming out from the bear. At least now the Sacred Relic is up on the bear, and we're getting very, very close to the Radiance. But by that time that hits, we've already got BKB up on Pycat. And Misery has a mech, and he's got that Hand of God. So you've got all the life back in. And we're going Tong Fu dewarding again. Or trying to. And then they give it up. They see the pressure coming in. And even Skewer away by Veronica. Tong Fu are running scared right now.
Yeah. You don't want to be in that position when you don't even dare to go deward.
Oh, there goes the tier 2 tower. And LGD. They can force this. There's no reason why they can't force this. We're 19 minutes into the game, and they have all the strength in the world to push in. That is one reason maybe why they won't force it, though. One, the TP on tower is going down bottom lane, but two, we just hit nighttime again.
Yeah, but I mean, they don't need to. They have complete control here.
Especially with now an armlet up on Nakes. It's going to rack up his damage even higher. So we've got armlet on Nakes, we've got BKB up on Luna. We've even got 1,400 gold, almost 1,500 gold up on 1437.
It's nighttime, and they even see that God is away from the team, but they still don't dare to go into their own woods.
Well, they can't. They want to get rid of the... Yeah, they finally get rid of that ward. One quick void out of Pycat, but this is because the pressure is meant to be applied there.
Yeah.
LGD will give it up for the moment. They're going to keep that pressure out in middle lane, or Veronica. Too far out, but there's support coming in very quickly. But they're looking over towards Roshan, and this could be... it could be a bad decision right now by LGD International. Because Tong Fu had this wonderful thing called reverse polarity.
Yeah, but Tong Fu won't dare to come close enough to use it.
That's true. And they can't get out too. This, okay, yeah. Even if they come, LGD put one precautionary, two precautionary. And then it forms
that sort of box around them.
Yeah, they got three wards looking for it all. And even though they had a dire ward looking at them, Tong Fu, they couldn't stop it. Mu comes up towards the top lane during his second nighttime cycle, and he farms. This is what he is brought to.
Yeah.
And Sergei is rushing up a sheep stick. Sheba's guard. He already bought the Vanguard. But he's... It's just so much fun. What is his gold per minute? It's still 456. 443 for Luna, 350 for Nakes. And then we hit Lone Druid at 337, who has a Radiance up. So there's a small possibility that he can keep these lanes pushed. Enough to give a little bit more space for Magnetor as well as Night Stalker to farm.
600 gold to the Shiva's guard. Or is it...
It's Shiva's. Done? It's Shiva's, because he already got the plate mail. Yeah, done. Yeah, Shiva's guard is done.
It's done, yeah. That's nice.
1437's walking around spending his cash on Gem, Tranquil Boots, and Bracer. So he wants to ensure that Tong Fu is blind on the map. And right now they have managed to get at least some... aggressive wards out across the map. We got one watching that top rune. And... Well, actually, that's a defensive ward too inside the jungle. That's it.
But none of those wards will stand because 1437 has his gem.
That's if he walks in close enough.
We got a blink. Well, if he doesn't walk in close enough, what use has the ward been?
And Veronica, is he sitting on the edge of vision? Yeah, he's sitting just on the edge of the vision there. They've got to smoke up and go out with this blink dagger on Veronica. They've got to make an opportunity with this. They're smoking along DD, and I think all three of them are waiting for it. But now there's trouble. Mu, too far out. Shiva's guarded up way too slow. He even popped the nighttime to try and get himself away just then, but it obviously is going to have no effect whatsoever apart from extending of the normal nighttime.
What does Lifestealer want next?
Well, if I was Lifestealer, I'd be looking at even more damage dealing and head into a Desolator or a Basher with the Abyssal. Yeah, that'll work. Nightstalker is trying to build up towards that BKB. And they did buy the Mithril Hammer before he died. Didn't lose too much gold, but it's still going to be frustrating. Wilkins are in. They need the Creep Wave to follow through with them. There's no Creep Wave right now, so they're just destroying off the Dire One inside the base. And the Saddle Blast is even keeping Veronica back a little bit further. This bear is going to be very, very cautious. He's just Radiant's burning down Pycat, but Pycat also has lifesteal. He managed to buy up his helm of the Dominator now. So he's even capable of converting the dire creep wave to fight for himself.
Centaur died.
That's force like LGD back for the moment. So 24 minutes in. And Tongfu. Again, they group up in the middle lane.
Well, then Chen is closing up on the farm of Magnus and Nightstalker.
Let's give him some time in the jungle. That's all he really needs.
Yeah.
Praxis have a lot of cash. What do we got flying up right now? So we got a cloak flying up. It's coming the way of Misery, so it's possible he'll also get the pipe for his team. But, well, let's have a shooting. No, that's actually for Sergei. It's for God up here on the top. So we're going to put Sheba's guard, Vanguard. Oh. What do we get? I'm hearing Entangle. Yeah, it's going to be Howe. Completely caught out of position. Ensnare, whole town position. Now, think about Sunsheng as well. At the end of the day, they'll just settle for the lone druid.
Yeah.
Actually, they're going to get Sunsheng as well. Pycat's here. He's going to creep wave with him, but he's not going to pop off the Eclipse for this one. Just his right click damage with a loose and beam is enough to kill off Sunsheng. And he had his heal running the entire time and pop the wards, but it's almost 200 damage per hit. And now God also has an Aix inside him. So they'll look for the startup. Yep, surging in. Nakes pops out. Wasn't close enough to move, but he gets the open wounds up, and then the damage on the long DD. Shiva's guard slows him down. The Iron Shell wears out at the same time we go for that engagement. Then three caught in the reverse polarity, skewing them back in past the tower. Shockwave to go, and then the Eclipse pops up from Pycat. Bears on low life. There goes the Night Stalker. And well, Howe as well as Veronica move back. If he loses that bear, he won't have another one for over a minute. So this will be LGD. Fortification will slow them down. But it's just Tongfu trying to wear him out. So Veronica at least pulls the creep wave aggro out, but he's getting damaged by the tornado as well as everything else. And Howe, too far up. And look at Praxis open up on him. He's still at 3k gold, and this bouncing glaive is doing a lot of damage. Pycat, oh no, he overcommitted. Got entangled, but then again.
He's got Aegis.
And it was going to be reclaimed in 1 minute, so it was all worth it popping off. And now he comes back up again, back into a... Oh, no wall. Well, maybe. Oh, the wall's on cooldown for the moment. But there was no follow-up. And they don't finish off that tower. It's on 26 HP, and Tongfu may as well deny that.
Yeah, but it's... They know it's dead, so... They'll get it next time.
And so I guess he'll be sent back to base. Bottle, and come back out again. Well, Misery just chills inside the jungle. Brax continues to farm up 3.1k. Up on him. Gold to be spent. Luna at least is keeping her cash coming in. And what have we got flying in? Yep, full Yasha now for Pycat. So not the Mana Style just yet, but he's got this like compilation of different items. Starting with the Satanic, going to the Mana Style. But doesn't need either of them like fully done just yet. The increase in damage and movement speed, as well as having the lifesteal and the BKB, is the only thing he needs to have done. Because that gives him everything he needs to help push out these lanes and be the aggression. God's going back in again. There's an Aix inside him. Howe, pull back in again with the Shiva's guard. The wall is up. Both Lina as well as Howe go down. And this will be a push that just won't be stopped. There's no reason for them to fall back right now.
Veronica, such a ridiculously tanky ball of death when a Darkseer comes running into you with a Lifestealer.
But the funny thing is, though, the tankiness was meant to be there for Tongfu. Sunsheng is now being three-hitted to death. Luna finishes him off, and Veronica has to skewer himself away to safety. But the tankiness is coming because, again, they've got this Chen up on Misery. Brax is already tanky as it is. The 1437 also gives everybody the space they need. If they get themselves in trouble, Disruption's directly after it. And there's a GG call out. Quite obviously, too, this advantage is well out of control for Tongfu. And LGD International will take game number one. Remember, this is a best of five. He actually bought Reaver for the
next game, Chen banned.
Well,
you have to.
But that's not the answer. It's not the answer to this.
It doesn't solve things, though.
No, it doesn't solve anything. Because at the end of the day, it was just strong laning, it was good rotation, and you can't just put it down to a Chen. Chen had a part in it, but really it was Sergei getting a good lane. He had a good time in middle lane up against Howe. Pike had a great time as well.
What else can you do to get them out of their comfort zone?
Out of the comfort zone? You've got to be as aggressive and stable as them. That's what it is. You've got to move between these lanes. Relying in a Magnetor ulti is not enough. Magnetor doesn't offer enough as to these lanes as you would hope. Because he has to, like, we're talking about where you play passive on the long lane as the Magnetor, and that is the way, like, you find these levels, you find this experience, and then later on, you have your arcanes and your blink and you go for a team fight. But when you team fight, you got heroes like Darkseer who are your instant counter to the team fight, and not to mention he is tanky as hell, so you can't kill him off. And then you got Nakes who just jumped out of the rage, you got Hand of God, you got all these things that give you so much control during a team fight after you've been initiated on. And they also were able to kite Tongfu. So much melee was there for Tongfu that they couldn't do anything. And the Witch Doctor pickup and the Lina pickup didn't work because they picked their three cores, the Lone Druid, the Magnetor, and the Night Stalker, all in the first set. And then you look at Lina and Witch Doctor as the last one. They took the best of what was left. And that is, it wasn't much.
That Magnus was a complete no-show. Just didn't have any impact. Even left alone to get his levels, to get some farm on the lane, and he did nothing.
Good to see God having some fun. Gotta get Ultra Kill inside it. I'm sticking to the very last stat screen because I know you guys like to see that.
Hey, I'm all for God getting some kills in because I've got him on my fancy team.
So it's all coming down to always. As long as your fantasy team wins, then G League is all. Then you're successful in life.
Yeah.
All right, guys. So that's gonna be the end of game number one. No matter what happens, there's only one more game today. We only play a maximum of two games of this best of five today, and that is just the way she rolls. We come back tomorrow at 13 CET. And we play out the final one. But remember, too, we've got a lot of defense games coming up later tonight, starting, I believe, at 4:30 with Empire going up against NextKZ. That is 4:30 CET time. It's 16:45 CET. I'm wrong. I was off by 15 minutes. But, yeah, stick around. We'll be returning here with the last game of today's G League season number two semifinal.